Hello and welcome to ProfDale's property video number 49. In this video, we're going to learn about the English feudal system of land ownership and how it impacts, to a surprising degree, modern property law. The feudal system was originated in England by William the Conqueror. But to understand William's background, we need to go back about 150 years to the time when Norsemen, or as we'd call them today, Vikings, conquered Normandy on the west coast of France. When the Norsemen arrived, they adopted French culture and language and also became Christian. And William was descended from these Norse conquerors. William had a plausible claim to the English throne. He said that Edward the Confessor, the previous English king, had designated him as his successor. Edward died in 1066, and the other principal claimant to the throne was Harold Godwinson. By about 1060, William had established his control over Normandy, and he set his sights on the English crown as well. In October of 1066, William crossed the Channel with his army, won the Battle of Hastings against Harold Godwinson, and became King of England. Incidentally, you can still see today some of the architectural remnants of William's rule, the Tower of London built by William himself, and Westminster Hall, which was built by his son and successor, William II. We know a good deal about the circumstances in England at the time of William's succession to the throne because of the Domesday Book. The Domesday Book was commissioned by William in 1085. He sent a team of clerks throughout the realm, and they recorded landholdings, houses, the number of men, plows, and animals on each farm and in each settlement. There were about 13,000 settlements in England at that time, and the population was roughly 1.5 to 2 million people. The Domesday Book was written by hand, of course, in Latin, and amazingly, it still survives today in the British National Archives. William brought to England from France the concept of the feudal system of land ownership. In that system, as it was established in England, there was a huge pyramid of ownership with the king at the top. The purpose of the pyramid was to allocate land holdings, to facilitate raising an army, and to ensure to the king the loyalty of those below him. The king allocated land throughout the nation to his barons. The barons were the principal leaders in his military campaign to take control of England. The barons, in turn, allocated part of their land holdings to knights who had served under them. The knights, in turn, might allocate part of their land to tenant farmers, and each of the farmers might have serfs working under him who did the actual manual labor in the fields. Thus, a huge pyramid was created with the king at the top and serfs at the bottom. In some cases, as many as 8 layers have been discovered between the top and bottom of this pyramid. A person who held land in this system might hold one of 2 main types of legal estates. The first, what we'd call today a fee simple absolute. That's an estate of perpetual duration. It would last indefinitely in the future and could be inherited by the holder's heirs when he or she died. The other kind of main estate was the life estate, which would end when the holder passed away. Transferring ownership of land in this system was done by a process called fefment with livery of season. In this process, the parties would meet on the land itself, and the person transferring the land would pick up a clod, a rock, or a twig that was emblematic of the land and would physically hand it over to the person receiving the land. This was done in the presence of witnesses. This was done without a writing because, of course, most people were illiterate, so transfers using a written deed as we do today simply wasn't feasible. In this system, anyone except the king himself might hold dual roles, both as an overlord to the tenants below him and as a tenant to the lord who was above him. Between each overlord and his tenants, there was a personal relationship. First, the overlord would promise protection to the tenants. The tenants, in turn, would swear an oath of homage and fealty to the overlord and would make a promise of services, much like rent today, to be paid to the overlord. The types of feudal services that a tenant might promise to his or her overlord depended on their relationship. At the upper reaches of the feudal pyramid, the services were usually military. A knight, for example, might promise one of the barons that the knight would go into the field of battle for 40 days each year. If the tenant was a religious organization, such as an abbey or monastery, it might promise to provide prayers or masses for the overlord. Sometimes there was a personal relationship between an overlord and his tenant. For example, a faithful retainer might promise a rose at midsummer, or might promise once a year to shine the overlord's armor. At the lower reaches of the feudal pyramid, the products were usually agricultural in nature. The serfs and the tenant farmers would promise to provide bushels of wheat or potatoes to the overlord. And finally, sometimes cash money was the promise that was made. There was one thing about this system that was very strange to us. That is, that one would owe rent in the form of these feudal services we just talked about, even if one had a fee simple estate, that is, an estate of perpetual duration. Today, we would not think that made any sense, to own a property in fee simple and yet owe rent on it. But that was really, in a way, the essence of the feudal system. Over time, the feudal incidents changed. First, by agreement of the parties, many of them were changed from specific services to their cash equivalents. The king, for example, found that having a bunch of elderly knights promise to go in the field for 40 days a year was not a very effective way of raising an army. The king would rather have cash. Second, because of inflation over the centuries, the value of those feudal services in cash became less and less important. In effect, they shrunk to the point where, in many cases, they were hardly worth collecting at all. Let's talk for a moment about the methods by which an estate or ownership of land could be transferred in this system. There were two methods, substitution and subinfeudation. In a transfer by subinfeudation, the person receiving the transfer became the subtenant of the person making the transfer. This meant that in a subinfeudation type of transfer, there was a brand new layer that was added to the feudal pyramid. The consent of the transferor's overlord was not needed, and the overlord's rights against the original tenant were not changed by this type of transfer. The overlord, therefore, could not charge a fee or exercise any right of disapproval if his tenant wanted to make a subinfeudation type of transfer. The other type of transfer was known as a substitution. The transferee stepped into the shoes of the transferor. In a substitution type of transfer, no new layer was added to the system. The consent of the overlord was required, and the overlord could charge a fee, which was called a fine for alienation, if his tenant wanted to make a transfer by substitution. Now, in addition to the benefits of receiving the feudal services that we talked about, the agricultural products, the prayers and masses, the military services, there were other additional benefits of being an overlord as well, and we'll call them the feudal incidents. Don't confuse them with the services. They were extra benefits of being an overlord. We're going to talk about three of them: escheat, wardship, and marriage. Here's the way escheat worked. If a tenant died and his line of heirs had run out so that he had no heirs, the overlord could take back the estate that the tenant had held. The same would be true if the tenant was convicted of a felony. Now, you might not think that would happen very often, but remember that heirs were much more narrowly defined in these days than they are today. So it was actually fairly common for a tenant to die without any heirs, allowing the overlord to take back the estate. The second extra benefit we'll mention was called wardship. It held that the overlord had the right to use and take the profit from the land of any minor tenant owner until she or he reached age 21, and the overlord had little or no duty to account for the money that would be collected in that manner, so that could be quite enriching to the overlord. And the third of these extra benefits or incidents of the feudal system was called marriage. It held that the overlord had the right to select a husband for a female owner, and in effect to sell for money the right to marry her. Now, these three incidents of being an overlord, escheat, wardship, and marriage, were derived in specie from the land itself, and therefore they did not decline in value with inflation. They amounted to the use and profitability of the land. So over time, they became much more important than the feudal services. Tenants in this system and their lawyers realized fairly quickly that they could avoid the impact of these incidents on their children by transferring land to them by sub-infeudation while they were alive and only charging nominal services to them, rather than by letting the land pass to their children by inheritance. If that occurred, then the tenant's overlord would not become the children's overlord, and the overlord would not be able to collect those feudal incidents from the children. Of course, the king was the biggest overlord of them all, and therefore the king lost considerable revenue as a result of his chief tenant's practice of passing the land to their children by sub-infeudation rather than by allowing it to pass by inheritance. Finally, in the year 1290, King Edward I persuaded Parliament to put a stop to this practice by enacting the statute Quia Emptores. And Quia Emptores in most American states is theoretically still the law today. The statute provided that no longer would any transfers by sub-infeudation be allowed except by the king himself. No other tenants could add layers to the feudal system. At the same time, the statute provided that overlords could no longer charge a fee or fine or withhold their consent if their tenants wanted to make a transfer by substitution. So substitution became the only form of transfer available. The statute Quia Emptores has a couple of important implications for modern property law. The first of those is that a grantor who transfers a fee simple estate cannot reserve rent on it. In other words, if you own an estate that's to last in perpetuity, or in fee simple as we say, you cannot be obligated to pay rent to the person who sold you the land. The second implication is that the right of a fee simple owner to transfer or alienate his or her land cannot be restricted or restrained by his or her transferor. Now, that rule is not absolutely enforced today. It's more of an attitude on the part of the courts. The courts frown on any attempt by someone to transfer land to another and then restrict the ability of the person receiving the land to retransfer it. The statute Quia Emptores really marked the beginning of modern land sales. It tacitly admitted that a personal relationship between the overlord and the landholder was no longer essential. At the same time, it signaled the ultimate destruction of the feudal system, because no additional layers could be added to the feudal pyramid, and the existing layers gradually disappeared because of escheats. By the time the United States was founded, the feudal system had virtually disappeared in England, and very little of its vestige was transferred to the United States. Land held in fee simple in America is held alloyedly, and that means that it's free of any obligation to an overlord or previous owner. I hope you've enjoyed this visit to the feudal system and its implications for modern property law. Thanks for watching.